based on a much longer presentation that I use a few times on events like this. But I've stripped it down to really focus on the sort of things that you guys are likely to be doing. Based on quite a lot of experience, I was in the industry, Rolls-Royce Aerospace, for 30 odd years, at the edge or the interface between the real world doing business and the IT providing world, I kind of did the translation back and forth. I've been at the University of Derby now for about 15 years. In fact, worked for Richard while he was here and he left just recently. The context is very much how things are changing. The analytics is becoming more and more and more important, and yet it's becoming ever more difficult to find people who can do the job. You're also running into big problems in terms of the numbers of people directly in your company. You're not doing IT, you can't do analytics, but doing business jobs, you need to understand the limitations and capabilities of analytics. That's what the left-hand side from McKinsey survey showed. And then the right-hand one shows the amazing value that we can get, potentially, if we do it right, if we use the right information on corporate and business governance, get the right sort of things coming out there. Very, very large rewards. Remember, if these are annual numbers in trillions of dollars, $11 trillion, we have a GDP, world GDP, of only about 65, 70 trillion dollars. So we're looking at huge values if we can do it right. I'm going to start off, as the conference is about IT and digital leadership, I'm going to start off with a few thoughts about leadership. I'll lead through a question of our data. Can we even trust our data? If we can't trust our data, we have real problems. I was going to do a little bit more on GDPR until I actually looked at the agenda yesterday and came to the conclusion you probably had more than your fill of GDPR. But there is one thing that I really want to talk about in the world of analytics that GDPR is going to bring that's rather, rather interesting. And there's an appendix at the end which looks at 12 different words beginning with V, starting with traditional, three of volume, velocity, variety. But I'm posing them not as definitional V's, but as question V's that you can use to improve your information technology governance quite significantly. I'm not going to go through those. There's quite a lot of ideas there that you will want to look at when you get hold of the presentation itself in terms of the leadership or managing. Two very, very different skills, two very, very different types of things. I'm going to be talking mainly about the leadership thing. Nice image. You can say that management is about corralling things, managing things from behind. This is a traditional way of looking after sheep in the West. Although I saw this happening only a couple of days ago up in Wales, I think it was, leading from the front. Leadership is about setting the tone, setting the direction. Five interesting thoughts here about vision, about passion, about walking the talk, communication and courage. Five important skills that are traditionally about what a leader really does. But I've been the, sorry, there is one other thing actually that goes with this, I thought I got another slide in there. There's another aspect which has affected me dramatically in the last 2 or 3 years. Those five are great, but there's two others that are utterly critical, I think, that need to be added. Inspiration and empowerment. You want your staff, your teams, to really deliver for the benefit of themselves and for your company and for you individually and personally. That inspiration and that empowerment is amazing in its effect. I wouldn't be here if I hadn't been inspired and empowered by my two leaders over the last 3 years. It's an amazing effect. So, culture. The leader sets the culture. We've seen in LinkedIn, in the press, and so on, about Kalanick, the leader, well, sorry, the owner, virtually, of Uber. We've seen the catastrophe that he's made of the thing over the last few months. Four or five different things where the CIO, sorry, CTO, CEO, whatever he calls himself, he has set the company up for a pretty interesting situation over the next few months, next few years. As a result of allowing that technology theft of the Google car technology, that box on the top, they could have, if the government goes to court, which it almost certainly will do, they could have a stay of development of probably 10 years imposed upon them under American law. So leadership, those five elements plus inspiration plus empowerment, set culture. If you get the culture wrong, you're in big trouble. I'm going to cover a few little items here, which you may be familiar with some of them. Some of them, I hope, are newish. Data. We've got data from all over the sort of place. I've been collecting data in various ways from the top left-hand one, the bottom one, and the right-hand one, all Fitbit, to find out how much the data is accurate. And the limitations. I've been getting my students, undergraduate students, doing research for the last 3 years about the accuracy of location data, location services. But we've got corporate data, things like SAP, we've got stuff coming in from the tills in the supermarkets and so on and so on and so forth. Stuff that Richard was talking about, video, etc. Lots of different sources of data. The problem we have is not that it is all accurate or that it is all inaccurate. The problem is, as John Neeson from IBM pointed out, 5 years ago now, something like 80% of all of the data we have around us is of uncertain veracity. We don't know which data are correct, how much data are incorrect, or by how much. Even in our corporate databases, you do an ERP implementation, you cull 70% of your master data, ship the remaining 30% into your new system, and you're wrong to assume that it will stay correct for more than 2 or 3 years. And one of the problems is that when we discover it, it has no consequence. I mean, I know some data in our master data in our systems at Derby about me which are incorrect. But it has no impact on me whatsoever, and I can't be bothered to phone up HR and spend 10, 15 minutes trying to get it sorted. It'll stay incorrect for the next 20 years or till I retire. Because it has no consequence on me or on anything other than somebody who might want to do some analytics. Which department do I live in? They got it wrong. Does it affect me? Nope. So I'm not going to bother. So I can't be bothered. I'm more important things to do. So we don't know which data is right and wrong, and that's one of the problems. Location services on our mobile phones. We tag our photos, we have it used by Costa or whoever to target us with location service-based adverts. Are they right? Are they wrong? How accurate? I've got photos which are tagged 22 kilometres out. That was the first one on the top left which showed me I've got an interesting project for my students. Top of Montreal, middle one, 5,000 metre error. And I'm at perfect visibility at the top of Montreal in Montreal. Assisted GPS sitting in my conservatory averaged around about 15, 20 meters accuracy over 24 hours, that is. If I've got pure GPS in the garden, 5-6 meter circular error. Question really is, what accuracy do you need? Don't be scared just because I've got examples of 1800 kilometer error examples here even. What you need to be doing with all of this data, whether it's location data or anything else, is working out what's your vulnerability, V for vulnerability. If you're Costa, it doesn't matter if you're 10, 15, 20 meters out, because that person is going to go past the shop. How often are you going to be targeting someone where they are 50 kilometers away? Or 60 or 100? Because your users might get a little bit hacked off if they keep getting adverts for their local Sheffield Costa when they're actually in Derby at the time. So your reputation vulnerability, if you're not careful. ThinkNear have been doing a lot of work, location-based advertising, over the last 3 years. The worrying thing here is that 35% roughly of, just under 28% is roughly 60 miles or more inaccurate. I haven't done the check inside here to find out where the phone thinks it is, but it's almost certainly not in this room. It had problems if you're the emergency service. In the States, the emergency service have been a big problem because they like to use those gadgets. But if you're at the top of it, halfway up a flat block of apartments, standard steel built with cladding and so on, you could be this side of the road or that side of the road, and it will not get the height right. At Montreal, when I was up there, it never, after 25 minutes, never settled on the altitude that I actually was at. It was still 20-30 meters out. These gadgets. 30% error difference between different gadgetry. Does it have a consequence? Oh, the other thing is we've done a lot of stuff coming from social media. In the good old days of statistics, people actually knew how to design experiments and decide how big the sample frame should be and so on, to work out how many N they needed to get valid answers. And for the Gallup poll, it was about 1,700 people across the country with a carefully selected group of people to predict the general election in plus or minus 3%. Then along come these things, and people say, oh gosh, we've got all the data we need, N equals all. N equals very, very small, very, very biased. Now, if you're looking on the various rating sites, a lot of people I've talked to in restaurants and cafes say, we don't look at it. Because the only people who actually rate us are the ones who've got an upset. We've known in marketing for 30 years. If I have a good experience, I might perhaps tell 3 people. If I have a bad experience, I'll tell 10 or more about it. So social media, you need to think incredibly carefully how you use it. Santander were very, very clever a few years ago when they first started using Twitter, I think it was. Not to go shoot the cashier who had caused a disaster or an upset, but to go and investigate what was wrong with the process. So looking at the process, not the person. An early indicator of something in the process is going wrong. So you have to think very carefully how you use those algorithms. Now the one thing I want to pick up on what Di was talking about from GDPR is algorithms. Transparency and explainability of those algorithms. But also, if we look at all three of these, there's an interesting question of business ethics. Cambridge Analytica developed, from Michael Kaczynski's stuff, the analytics that delivered extremely targeted SMS messages and advertising, effectively, to the whole of the USA. Kaczynski discovered that if he had 69 likes on your Facebook profile, We can tell with about 88% accuracy your skin colour. With 150 likes, he understood, or his algorithms would understand your personality better than your parents did. Most people who use Facebook have not 50 or 100 likes, they've got tens of hundreds of likes. Think how well those sort of algorithms can understand people. Now, when it's used in politics, maybe when it's used in marketing even, we have to think carefully about business ethics. Target. Who's heard of the Target pregnancy testing example? A few years back, starting actually 2005-06. The long and the short of it is that a big exercise discovered that they could identify pregnant women in their customer base based on their purchasing patterns, plus a lot of stuff that they probably couldn't have acquired legally in the UK or in Europe. Did lots of stuff, started using the information they got back. They could tell which trimester the women were in, they could even predict, roughly speaking, when they're going to deliver their baby. Sent out booklets of coupons. A father turned up in one of the shops and in the USA, very, very angry, demands to see the manager, and weighs this and said, "What are you trying to do, get my 16-year-old daughter pregnant?" The manager apologized, he didn't know anything about it, we'd try and find out, we'd phone back in a week, did so. Answer came back from the father, "I'm very sorry. There was something I didn't know that was going on in the family. My 16-year-old daughter was pregnant, she hadn't got back to telling us." There's a lot of debate as to whether it's accurate, whether it's right or wrong. I think the evidence is probably that it's correct. You can still find the news articles about it. The question, though, is, from our business ethics aspect, is, are there questions that ethically we should not ask of our data, version one, or having asked our data the questions, are the things that we ethically should not do once we've done it? The jury's out. You have to make that decision as a leader, yourself, your team, to work out whether you should have ever got yourself into the target position of being able to identify pregnant women or not. And if you have, should you or should you not be marketing with coupons to try and fix their behaviour for the future? And GDPR, can you explain how those algorithms actually work at all? But there is an interesting consequence about these fitness trackers. One is that too many people are using them without understanding how inaccurate they are. They rely on them, they have their own, let's say, calorie tracking app, and their target is, say, 2,500 calories of burning exercise each day, and they see they've got 3,500 today. Side. Wow, I can have a blowout, so I can have another double Mac. And we've seen that people using these fitness trackers, not the professionals, not the highly active, but a lot of other people are using them, are actually growing fatter rather than thinner because they're relying too much on inaccurate information. The top two are much, much more serious and raise very serious business ethics questions, given that the trackers don't measure the activity particularly accurately in terms of steps, in terms of distance, or almost anything else. There are several insurance companies in the UK and in the USA who are now giving massive discounts or significant discounts on health insurance if you meet your activity targets. Now, if I were to be offered that and I had the choice between my iPhone and that Vivo Smart, I would use that because that calculates top 50% more steps than my Vivo Smart does. I have no idea which one's correct. So either I'm taking you as an insurance company for a ride, or else you are taking me for a ride because you know that they aren't terribly accurate. And so and the one in the UK is particularly wicked, in my view, from the ethics position, because they will fine me £12 per week every week I fail to meet my fitness target. And if that's on their device that is counting low, that's a con to me. You may have heard on Radio 4 a few months ago about a company, an insurance company for health, pet health, discount if you have their little fitness tracker that goes under their collar. And the example was a golden retriever, I think it was, requires 60 minutes of activity per day. So they got one and took it for over 60 minutes of activity that day. Long walk, got back at the end of the day, 5 minutes had been actually logged. Discounts kind of not allowed. Is that good business ethics on something that is that inaccurate? 5 minutes instead of, actually I think they said it was 65 minutes. 1/13th accurate. The message is, think about the data, think about the algorithms which are involved here that are turning this incredibly sensitive little three-axis accelerometer data into counts of steps, estimates of calories and so on. Are they actually effective? Maybe they're not. It's not that these are fundamentally wrong, but what are you going to do with it? Right? Is your analysis going to be lawful now under GDPR? Because if your algorithms with this sensitive, personally sensitive data like health are kind of wildly wrong, that kind of could become an interesting issue. Machine learning is another area I want to talk on very, very briefly. Do we know what these little beasties are learning, particularly it's things like neural networks? The example here is one that came out a few years ago using machine learning to detect the difference between friendly and enemy tanks. Huge stack of traditional machine learning neural network training, two sets of data, enemy, friendly, plus a reserve set for training, for testing. All worked perfectly well. Brilliant, 100% certainty. Except, accidentally, the military discovered it hadn't learned anything to do with tanks at all. It had learned all about identifying forests and sand in the deserts, which is slightly problematic. GDPR, I just put that quote in there. Internal and external audits should be undertaken with a view to explaining the rationale behind algorithmic decisions and checking for bias, discrimination, and errors. Neural networks prevent you doing any of that. No one has a clue what a neural network, especially the multi-layer convolutional ones where they're feeding back and so on. They're really difficult to understand. People try pretending that they can map the activity in the neural networks and comparing them with fMRI scans, where we can see the localized activity during speech or other activities. I'm trying to suggest maybe we could find out using that sort of top left hand corner one, this is what it's doing. It doesn't help you understand what the pictures are like or how it's learning or detecting stuff. We have to choose other ways. And then security and privacy by design, by default. My guess is this is going to change the way that people who sell almost all of these gadgets that we put in our houses which are Wi-Fi connected. Whereas today they come out of the box, we plug them in, probably leave admin as the password and SSID or whatever. I suspect that the simple solution that's going to be required is that they guide you through essentially the choice and use of a strong password. Right. You know, have you heard of D-Link, the people who provide little Wi-Fi routers and so on for your house? They're being taken to court at the moment by in America because they failed to provide adequate security on their little video cameras, which then became one of the sources of those huge DDoS attacks back in October last year. So I suspect that that's one of the consequences, is that people will begin to develop good security out of the box. You won't be able to use these things unless you do, because otherwise there is a potential, like with those two on the right, Kayla the doll and the cloud pet spiral toys, Teddy Bear, both of which are sold to parents so they can go with their children and then monitor them over the net on their phone, have conversations with them. And both of them have got very, very bad security. The bottom one, 850,000 sets of ID data, personal data, telephone numbers and so on, were found by an investigator on a totally unprotected server out on the cloud. That is an American company, and I suspect that as of 25th of May next year, a company like that will be taken to cleaners for 20 million euros, 4% of turnover fine for complete careless, more than careless, lack of security. And as I said, you know, most of you guys are going to be safe. You're companies which are kind of thinking sensibly about data protection. But the UK ICO is currently recruiting 250 auditors, targeting specifically SMEs and local government. And I wouldn't be at all surprised if Central European organisations are not beginning to build some interesting cases for international organisations. The GDPR applies to everybody in the world handling European Union citizens' data. So it doesn't apply just within the UK, within Europe. It applies worldwide. And there's going to be an awful lot of surprises in 12 months' time. The last little bit, we talked a lot about analytics and big data and so on. Big data in analytics only gives you the what sort of, or how much type of answer. It's statistics, pure and simple. It's got lots of lovely terms, lovely new modern names. It's actually just fundamentally bog standard statistics. I'll give you just two little examples. Alpha, who's heard of Alpha House? Anybody? No. You've all heard of House of Cards. Amazon created Alpha House and Netflix House of Cards. Alpha House has lasted two series, House of Cards 5 and going strong. They both started effectively the same way. A pilot, huge data collection, huge data analytics. Amazon took the analytics as fact, as the decision. The highest rated one was Alpha House. We'll go with it. Netflix, however, were much more sensible. They remembered the lessons we've learned over the last 50 years of IT. Do not let the machine make the decision. Humans make the decision. And they brought in a lot of intuition, a lot of practical filmmaking experience, directing, and so on and so forth. They were successful. They used lots of small data with the big data analytics. Amazon, just the big data, and fouled up. The bottom three are very, very interesting. They come from a guy called Lindstrom in a book, Small Data. Small data is the personal story that tells you a lot about the why. Why are things happening? Why are people, customers, making their decisions? Walmart used big data. They're pouring data through the system all the time. They only know how much. What's going on? Solving Lego required one insight, which was to see a pair of battered trainers in a 13-year-old customer of Lego back in 2004 when Lego were going through trouble. They discovered, Lego had thought that the problem with their sales of Lego was that these kids, some kind of millennials, had no time for anything, they were time poor. They wanted to be able to do things quickly. The insight that one pair of trainers in the house with an ethnographic research led them to understand that 13-year-old kids have all the time in the world to develop mastery for something they're interested in. You can't get that from big data. That's a small data that saved Lego completely. No big data could have helped Lego. And Lowe's is another one where same sort of small messages from individuals looking at people, talking to people, told them so much. Big data and small data together give you some stunning insights. Big data by itself, probably not a lot. Just tells you statistics what's happened in the past. So look forward, find those little stories, put them two together, and you've got something incredibly powerful to get towards that $11 trillion benefit. The algorithms, have a look at that one. It is important. We're going to have a lot of trouble, I suspect, over the algorithms over the next few years. So I leave the message with all of that. The need to think about the questions, to lead, to inspire, to empower. Where are you going to take your teams? How are we going to deal with analytics and governance in an era of uncertain data? Thank you.
Right, so we're a little over time. Just quick, any